Okay, so today we'll try to see what exactly is one of the important topics as part of ML and data science, which is your coordinate geometry. So under this, what we'll try to cover is if I give you a point in a two-dimensional space, P of x, y, how to plot it, how to plot a point P of x, y. We'll also study about your Cartesian coordinate system and then equation of straight line. These three topics we'll try to cover today as far as possible. So if you have your x and y system, this becomes your positive x axis, your plus x, this would be your minus x, this would be your y and your minus y. I think this is very elementary. Now any point in this space can be represented in this fashion, P of x, y. And before that, we should know that this is your first quadrant. Here, both x and y are positive. Here, you have x negative and y positive. Similarly, here we have both negative, and here we have x positive and y is, this forms your coordinate system. Now if I have any point here, right, so this would have values, should be a 1, should be a 2, 3, 4 and so on. This would be minus 1, this would be a minus 2 for negative x, and then we have y which is 1, 2, 3 and so on. Again here we have minus 1, minus 2, minus 3 and so on. So any point, if I have to represent any point on this plane, then when I say, suppose I have one point P of 2 comma 3, this particular point, if you want to represent it, this point, it means that it is 2 units from the x axis and 3 units from the y axis. So in this case, I have to take 2 units from the x axis, which is here at x equals 2, and 3 units from the y axis. That means the point comes somewhere here, correct? 2 comma 3. This becomes your P of 2 comma 3. This is how you will represent a point in first coordinate. And suppose if I have some other point, let's say I have Q of minus 2 comma minus 3. In this case, it is minus 2 units from the x axis. That means I have to go down from the x axis, I mean towards the left of the origin, and then I have to go 3 units below. So this point will lie somewhere here. If this is minus 3, then my point will lie at this point. This will be your Q, which is minus 2 comma 3. Okay. This is how you will represent two points. Now given two points like this, the next thing is, given two points, how will I form the equation of a line? Equation of a line joining any two points in your coordinate system. For that, suppose I want to draw a line between P and Q. That is, if this is Q and this is P, I want to draw a line that goes between P and Q. I want the equation of this particular line. So there are five ways to get the equation of a line. I mean, there are five formulas or five representations. We look at the most important equations of a straight line, that is three of them. So I'll just erase this quickly. So let's assume I have the same two points. Here I have P of 2 comma 3, and here I have Q of minus 2 comma minus 3. Now I want to arrive at the equation of the line PQ. I want to know what is the equation of this particular line. So to get the line joining P and Q, right, I need two things. One is, the first representation will become the slope intercept form. So I have, the equation will be something like y equals mx plus c. Now here m stands for slope of the line, and c will stand for your y intercept. Y intercept. Now when I say slope and y intercept, our first thing will be to learn what exactly you mean by slope and what do you mean by intercept. So if I take this particular line, right? Suppose this is our line L. When I say intercept, it is the point at which the line cuts the positive y-axis or the x or the y-axis in general. So this particular distance becomes your y-intercept. So this is the value C. That is the distance from the origin till the point on the y-axis where the line cuts the y-axis. This becomes your C. Again, this is your x-axis, and this becomes your y-axis. The other one, which is my slope M. Slope M is nothing but tan. If this is theta, then slope becomes basically tan of that angle. Tan theta is your M. That is the angle the line makes with the positive x-axis. Right? The angle the line makes with the positive x-axis is called as the slope of the line. So this is called as your slope-intercept form. Slope-intercept form of a straight line. That is y equals mx plus c, where I just have to give two variables. One is my m, and the other is or two constants, which is m and c, and x and y are my equation variables. Now, going back to our first question, which is I had to draw the equation of this particular line. So I have c, which is 2, 3, and then I have q, which is -2, -3. I want to find the equation of the line PQ. So for that, first of all, I need two things as usual, which is one is my slope, right? I need slope is what I need to find. Now, coming to tan theta, the actual formula for tan theta will be, if I have any triangle like this, right? Suppose I have two points defined here. I have two points. Let's assume these two are both P and Q. Now, given these two lines, tan theta is nothing but, if I can just draw a small triangle here, it is this particular angle. Suppose I have two points here, one here and the other one here. When I say tan theta, all I'm trying to find is, I want this particular angle. I'm interested in tan of this angle. And as you know, your tan of any angle is nothing but sine of that angle, sine of theta divided by cos of the same angle. So in this particular figure, if these are A, B and C, then as you know, your sine theta is what? That is AC by AB, and cos will be BC by AB. Basically, it becomes AC by BC. That is your Y by X. So, if I actually remove this, it finally becomes equal to Y over X, or rather, it is the change in Y over change in X given any two points. So, tan theta of any two points, if I want to find the equation of that straight line, it is nothing but the change in Y over change in X. That is what I am interested in. So, going by that formula, your M basically becomes, if I have P, if this is my X1 and Y1, and this is X2 and Y2, then my M, which is my slope, is nothing but Y2 minus Y1, that is the change in Y, over X2 minus X1, that is the change in X. So the same formula, I am taking it over here. The change in Y over change in X is nothing but Y2 minus Y1 by X2 minus X1. This gives you the slope of any line. Using the same formula, so if I am interested, so for P and Q points, my M basically becomes, as you know here, it is a modulus here for both X and Y. That means I can take both X1 minus X2 or X2 minus X1. Because I am taking modulus, it is always positive, both for Y as well as X. So for P and Q, my value of M becomes mod of -3, because -3 minus of plus 3, right, divided by minus 2, again mod, minus 2, minus 2. So this becomes basically your 6 by 4, which is 3 by 2. So now we have arrived at the value of m. The next thing I want while I am trying to find the equation of the line PQ is what we saw in the slope intercept form. What we saw is that we had y equals mx plus c. Now this equation can be used if I know both m and c, but here I was only able to find m, c I don't have it yet. So we have another equation of the same line, which is y minus y1 is equal to m, which is your slope, into x minus x1. This is also an equation of the same straight line. Both represent the same thing, but it depends on what is given and what is not. Because I have only m here and I don't have c, I cannot use the first equation. So it is y minus y1 equals m into x minus x1, and this is the most used form of a line because all I need is 2 points for this. Now here we have m, we already got m. Now coming to y1 and x1, it can be any of the 2 points. Can be both P and or Q. X and Y of both P and Q I can use. So I'll take P, which is 2, 3. So if I take that, my equation becomes Y minus Y1, which is 2, 3, right? So it is 3. Y minus 3 is equal to M. M is 3 by 2. 3 by 2 into X minus 2. I'm just taking this equation. I'm substituting the value of M from above, from here, and I have arrived at this equation, which is y minus 3 equals 3 by 2 into x minus 2. Now if I simplify this, it becomes 2y minus 6 is equal to 3x minus 6, right? 2y minus 6 is equal to 3x minus 6. Now this and this goes away and I am left with 2y equals 3x. 2y equals 3x or y equals 3 by 2x. Now taking this equation, y equals 3 by 2x, I'm going to erase everything now. Yeah, so this particular equation, y equals 3 by 2x, if I try to write it in the form y equals mx plus c, I see that the value of m is 3 by 2, straight correlation, whereas the value of c is actually 0. And when I say value of c is 0, it means it passes through the origin. So basically the line passes through the origin in this fashion. This is the origin. Right? If the value of c is 0, it means that it passes through the origin. Now this particular equation, right, y equals mx plus c, this is also called as a linear equation because the highest power of x in my equation is 1. Because highest power of x is 1, it is also called as a linear function or a linear equation. Now what else I can do with this? Now I have the equation of a line. Now if I have the equation of a line, there are a couple of things I can do with it. Suppose this is the equation of the same line that I have, which is y equals mx, let's say 3x plus 5. I have some equation, y equals 3x plus 5 is the equation of the line that I have here. Now the moment I take a small derivative, right, dy by dx, right, that is the, I mean, in its simplest terms, dy by dx means the change in y over corresponding change in x, correct? So when I take dy by dx for a straight line, we already did this, we arrived at tan theta, correct? Change in y over change in x is tan theta. So what you should know is, whenever you differentiate a straight line, you will get its slope. So if I take the same equation, I have y here, and if I do dy by dx, I'm going to get 3. 3 is the slope. That means if I take this angle and I measure tan theta of this, it will be 3. Or this is nothing but tan inverse of 3. So if I have a linear equation of the form y equals mx plus c and I differentiate it, I will always get slope of that line. Right? If I differentiate a single degree equation or a straight line equation, I will always get a slope. The other thing that you should be aware of is two things. Equation of a line that is parallel to the x-axis will always have the equation as, it's going to be of the form y equals k, which is k is a constant, and this will be the value of k. Correct? And equation of a line that's parallel to the y-axis will be of the form x equals k, where k is this value. Right? That means if I have a line parallel to the x-axis, that is y equals k, the slope of this will be tan of 0, right? Because it is not making any angle, it's not even this particular line is not even touching your x-axis. That is why tan of 0 is 0. Tan 45 is 1. So, slope of a line that is parallel to the x-axis has slope 0. Slope of a line parallel to the y-axis will have slope infinity, because tan 90 is infinity. This angle, right? This angle in that case. So, slope of a line parallel to the x-axis will have slope 0. And if it's parallel to the y-axis, I'll have tan 90, which is infinite. The other thing is, in the same coordinate system, if I have two lines, if I say two lines are parallel, it means, and I have slopes m1 and m2, the condition is m1 equals m2, if the two lines are parallel. Now, in the same way, if two lines are perpendicular, this is my L1, this is my L2, two lines that are perpendicular, in that case, and the slope of this is M1 and M2, it means M1 multiplied by M2 gives you minus 1. So, slope product of two slopes, product of the slopes of two lines that are perpendicular is equal to minus 1. If they are parallel, then they are equal. M1 equals M2. These are a few of the basic things with respect to straight lines. And suppose this particular straight line cuts your x-axis at a distance A and it cuts your y-axis at a distance B. Right? Then there is a way to arrive at the equation of this line also. And this becomes your intercept form or double intercept form. In that case, the equation becomes x by A plus y by b is equal to 1. This also represents the same equation. If I know the points at which it cuts both x and y axis, then I can arrive at the equation of the line in the following manner. I can say x by a plus y by b. X by the point at which x by x intercept plus y by y intercept equals 1. This also is the equation of the same straight line. If I have this particular equation, right, I have y equals, so we saw linear is y equals mx plus c, it means that it is the equation of a straight line. But if I give you something like y equals ax square plus bx plus c, then this is the equation of a quadratic or a polynomial equation, equation of second degree. So this basically represents the equation of a, parabola. Now, this is one more important form of a line or equation or a type of equation. It's a second degree equation, and I think you know how to find the roots, right? Formula is there, minus b plus or minus. So, the roots of this particular equation, when I say roots, it means the points at which it cuts the x-axis, these two points. Since it's a second degree equation, I'll have two roots. And to find these two roots, the formula is minus b plus or minus root of b square minus 4ac by 2a. This done, you've done this a million times, school and all. So, even any second degree equation, you should be knowing how to find the roots. Roots are nothing but where the equation cuts the x-axis. So, So coming back to second degree equation, suppose I have this particular equation, right? Let's assume this equation is a parabola and this is y equals some ax square plus bx plus c. If I have this particular equation, now this is y, and what I want to do is, if I simply take a derivative of it, if I take dy by dx, if I take dy by dx of this particular equation, I am going to be left with 2a plus b. So we see that if I differentiate a second degree curve, I have got a first degree curve. That is, from a parabola, I have got a straight line equation. Now, what does this straight line represent? It represents tangents drawn to that line at every x. So it is 2ax plus b. So 2ax plus b is the equation of the tangent drawn to this particular line, to this particular curve. Now, how can I show this is, let's assume I have this particular coordinate system here and I have my second degree equation like this. Now, after I differentiate it, this is y equals ax square plus bx plus c, and if I take your dy by dx, it is the, I get the equation of a straight line. So, I am going to get 2ax plus b. You can't see it, I don't know what's wrong. I've got 2ax plus b. Now, what this represents is, it represents equation of tangent drawn to this curve at every x. So, in this particular 2ax plus b, x is the only variable. So, as and when I change the value of x, I will get equation of the tangent at that point. Suppose this is the equation of the tangent at x equals 2. And then this is the equation of the tangent. You know what a tangent is, right? That is the curve at only one point. So tangent is a geometrical line that is drawn that touches any curve at only single point. So at x equals 2, it touches at this point. At x equals 3, it touches at this point. And let's assume this is at 3. And let's assume at this lowest point here, I get a flat line, right? I get a line parallel to the x-axis. Now, this is what I'm interested in, this point where my derivative is 0. That is, if I get the equation of this line, this will be an equation of a line that is parallel to the x-axis, correct? Now, and the point at which the derivative takes the minimum value is called as the local minimum. Now, why is this so important in machine learning is, whenever you are training any model, there are two things happening. One is, your error is decreasing as and when you train a model, right? Your error starts decreasing, your accuracy starts increasing. Now, how do I judge my error? Error is calculated as a function, as a second degree or a third degree function, and my job is to minimize that function. When I say minimize, I am trying to calculate my dy by dx, and I am trying to find out that point, like say this point P, where I get the least value of this particular curve. So for this particular curve, we know that the minimum value occurs at the point P, right? So that is got by differentiating it once. So I have my second degree curve. I differentiate it once, I got my first degree curve. That is, I got 2ax plus b. Now, this particular 2ax plus b is a tangent drawn to that particular parabola at different points as and when I change my x. Now, to find out the minimum value of that curve, I have to get to the point where my tangent becomes parallel to x-axis, correct? That represents the lowest point. So, to get that, I will have to, so the equation of the tangent is basically 2ax plus b. Should be equal to, derivative of this should be equal to 0, because the slope of the line should be 0. So if I differentiate this again, I'm going to get I'm going to get 2a equals 0, or at the point a equals 0. So I have y, let's say I have y equals 3x square plus 9x plus 5, right? A quadratic equation. Now if I differentiate this, if I take dy by dx, I'm going to get 6x plus 9, right? So your dy by dx equals 6x plus 9. So this is the equation of the tangent at various points for the curve. If I want the minimum value of my function, this is my main function, right? If I want the minimum value of this function, then I have to again differentiate this line to get the tangent where the slope is 0. So if I differentiate this again, so it becomes a second order derivative. If I take d square y by dx square 6, right? So that means at the point 6, at the point when x equal to 6, I am getting the minimum value of this function, right? So this means that at x equals 6, your y takes a minimum value. That is what I am able to arrive. So the whole point was, given any function, I to arrive at the minimum value of that function or the lowest point in that function, I have to differentiate it so many number of times. If I have a third degree curve, I have to first, if I differentiate it once, I get a second degree curve. Then again, I get a first degree curve, and then I get my slope where it's equal to 0. So what I'm trying to tell, if I want to brief this, then it's something like, given any f of x, given any f of x of nth order is, order is your highest power of x. Given any f of x of nth order, f of x min, to arrive at the minimum value of that function, I have to differentiate it. What I need to do is n times. That is the gist. Given any f of x of nth order, to arrive at the minimum value of that function, I just have to differentiate it n times. So if I have a fifth degree equation, I have to reduce it 5 times. Dy by dx, d square y by dx square, d cube y by dx cube, again and again. If I do it 5 times, I will get the equation of, or I'll get the point where the function takes the least value. We did for second degree, right? We can do the same for third degree also. For example, we'll do it for third degree. Suppose I have something like y equals x power 4 plus 3x cube plus 9x square plus 6x. Right? I have this. It's a fourth degree equation. It's a fourth degree equation. I want to arrive at the lowest value. So because it is a fourth degree equation, it will have four roots. And whenever you have a fourth degree equation, it is going to look something like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. It's going to be in this fashion because it's a fourth degree even curve. Right? So now I want to find out this point. I want to find out the value of that x where this function is taking the minimum value. That is what I want to do. For that, because it is a 4 degree curve, the first thing I will do is, I will do my first dy by dx. So if I do my first dy by dx, I will be getting 4x cube plus 9x square 18x plus 6. So this, as you can see, if I differentiate it once, I see that the power has fallen by 1. So I have to do it basically 4 times to get that particular x point. So if I do that again, it's going to be d square y by dx square. That again becomes 12x square plus 18x plus 18. So again, I have to differentiate. Now I've got a second degree function. If I do it again, it's going to become 24x plus 18. Now it is a straight line. So if I, after doing it 3 times, I have got the equation of the tangent, right? I've got the equation of the tangent that I can draw at every point. The next step, if I do it, I will get the equation where the tangent slope becomes 0. So if I differentiate this again, I'm going to get, so at x equals 24, we see that I'm getting the minimum value of this particular function. Now why this is important is because whenever you are building any ML or machine learning or deep learning model, is your error of the model is calculated as a cost function. So don't worry about this, but just try to imagine this. Your error, right? Your error is calculated. So two things are a product of any ML or deep learning model. One is your error function, and the other one is your accuracy. Right? And during the process of training, your error keeps on decreasing, whereas your accuracy keeps on increasing. Now, to measure this error, we have something called as the cost function. So, this error is measured as a cost function. It is very similar to your f of x that we just saw now. Now, the whole point of training is my cost function or f of x should reduce as much as possible. It has to go from a higher value to a lower value, or I need that point, like we tried to find this, right? We tried to find this particular point. We tried to find this point where our f of x takes the minimum value. This is exactly what I am trying to do in my machine learning training. I am trying to find this particular point where your cost function, which is a measure of your error, takes the minimum value. So, the moment your error takes the minimum value, it means that you have got the highest possible accuracy, right? Because error and accuracy are inversely proportional. And the moment you get the lowest value of error, it means that you have got the highest accuracy possible. So, the whole job of training is to find this particular point f of x, right? That is why your coordinate geometry or all your linear algebra, coordinate geometry and probability will play a very big part, especially coordinate geometry in trying to figure out that equation, cost function. Once you figure out the equation of the cost function, it is very easy to differentiate it and get its lowest value. But ideally in real life, you will not differentiate it so many times. We have built-in ML models which will do it for you. We have stochastic gradient descent, SGD, GD, and then we have so many other algorithms. They are called optimizers, which will find that point very easily for you. You don't have to differentiate it again and again. Line or the curve? This curve equation, basically, like I said, right, when you're training, depending on a couple of factors like activation function and a couple of other things which you learn a little later, you will get that equation of your cost function. You don't have to find it, you get it automatically as a part of that model. So whenever you build any ML model, right, let's assume you are building a simple face detection algorithm, face identifier, right, deep learning model. In that, your first layer, right, will be your input layer. So this basically becomes your input layer. The next model or the next layer happens to be your hidden layer. Hidden layer basically consists of your neurons or cells. You'll have many such hidden layers. You have 1, 2 and so many others, right? This is your input layer where you pass your data, your training data that you will have. You'll pass your input data. This is your hidden layer. And then finally, you will have an output layer. You will have an output layer which will classify it into, suppose I am trying to build a face detection for 50 people, right? Then there will be a particular neuron here, and all these layers, right, these are layers. So this is an input layer, these are many hidden layers, and this happens to be your output layer. When I say layer, they are just groups of cells. So you will have one cell here, one cell here, one cell here, one cell here, and so many such cells, depending on a lot of other things. So they are all very much interconnected. All these neurons are interconnected to every other neuron. Again, these to this, and finally, these are connected to your output neuron as well. Now, the important thing is, whenever you start training, right, when the data starts passing through your input layer, hidden layer, and output layer, we get two things out of it. One is your accuracy. The other is your cost function. Cost function is nothing but your f of x. So you don't have to find it out. It is a byproduct of model training. You get it by itself. But your job is to find out that minimum point. So this cost function is given to you by the model itself, using a couple of other something called optimizers, which we'll study later on. So now once I get this cost function, right, what happens is the cost function is backfed, or it is back propagated all the way back to the hidden layer. The cost function that I obtain, which is a measure of the error, that cost function is back propagated to my hidden layer, and the neurons in your hidden layer have two parameters. One is weight and one is bias. Now they self adjust. It's a process of learning, right? Like a baby starts to first crawl, and if it falls on a step, right, it will fall once the next time it understands that if I try to crawl on a step, it will fall down. So it will not do that. In the same way, these neurons which are part of this hidden layer will self-adjust to decrease that error. When I pass the cost function back to my hidden layer, these neurons change their weight and bias. So every neuron is basically represented. This is not required right now, but still is represented by a particular equation, which is y equals wx plus b. Wx plus b. W stands for your weight. B stands for your bias. X is my input, which I am passing. Now this weight and bias self-adjust. It is you can draw a parallel with a baby, learning not to crawl on the step. It knows that it should not crawl because it will get hurt. So in our sense, getting hurt is a measure of error. So the weights and biases will self-adjust to decrease that error. And over a process of time, over many epochs, or through over many iterations, the model will be so well learned that your error completely falls down, or that point is reached of minimum effort or minimum error. So we'll study all of this in detail. We'll do a lot of case studies for image processing, image recognition, text classification, and all that. This was just to introduce how coordinate geometry is used, and I think you should be up to date with differentiation, finding the equation of a line, and then how to differentiate. Basically, logarithmic differentiations are very much required. Log of dy by dx of log x, log e power x, all those.